Hello, and welcome to the sixth lecture in this series of lectures on applications of big data, machine learning, and artificial intelligence in scanning probe and electron microscopy. My name is Sergey Kalinin, and I work at the Center for Nanophase Material Science at Oak Ridge National Laboratory. In this lecture, we are going to discuss the quantitative data in scanning transmission electron microscopy. So how do we make an image more than an image? We are going to discuss the physics-based descriptors in STEM, parameters such as polarization, strain, and octahedra tilts. And then we are going to discuss how these parameter maps can be matched to the mesoscopic models, dynamic mesoscopic models, and stochastic models. So let's start from the very beginning. So traditionally, electron microscopy and scanning probe microscopy datasets are perceived just an image. So this is something that can illustrate the structure of your material, show the presence of the defects, illustrate the quality of the material, and so on. And of course, in the last 10 years, it has become normal to see very beautiful images in papers published all across the spectrum of the publications. However, what happened in the last 10 years is that the electron microscopy stopped being just imaging techniques. Currently, we can use the electron microscopy dataset to pinpoint atomic positions with picometer and sometimes better than picometer level precision. And this in turn allows us to use this information to infer the chemical and physical properties of materials. For example, the bond lengths in organic compounds are directly related to the chemical reactivity and catalytic activity. If I tell you the length of the carbon-carbon bond, and if you're an organic chemist, you would be immediately able to tell me whether this is a single bond, double bond, a triple bond, and speculate what would be the chemical reactivity of the corresponding compound. If you're a physicist and you know the bond angle and bond lengths, you can figure out whether the material is ferroelectric or not, whether it is metal or dielectric, and so on and so forth. And of course, once we obtain this information in the form of image, we can also see what are the configurations, repeating elements, what are the lattice sites, and so on and so forth. A few years ago, Steve Pennycook and myself wrote an opinion piece speculating that electron microscope is much more than just an imaging tool. It's a quantitative, structural, and functional tool, and many of the predictions that we made at that time were realized quite successfully. Now, the important thing about real materials is that we always have to deal with the coupling between the chemistry and physical behavior. For example, about 15 years ago, Nicola Spaulding and Manfred Fibig wrote the paper in Science on the renewal of the multiferroic effects and postulated that there is a lot of very interesting physics in coupling between electric field and polarization, strain and stress, and the magnetic field and magnetization. And this was a rebirth of the multiferroic materials. It turns out that in many materials, such as oxide, layered materials, and so on and so forth, we also have to deal with the chemical degrees of freedom. For example, the chemical potential of the volatile species, which is coupled to the concentration. Which means in turn that when we work with the real materials, we always have to pay attention both to physical and chemical degrees of freedom. Both of them are related to the strain or the lattice parameter, something that we can measure with the electron microscope remarkably well. But we also need to know the local composition or chemical strains that couples to the lattice parameter as well. So, how can we hope to learn physics and chemistry from the electron microscopy or scanning probe microscopy data? In this case, we can divide our problem in the four parts. So the first part is, how can we get material-specific information, for example, atomic coordinates from the STEM image or the scattering potential from the 4D STEM from the microscopy data? at which level of confidence, and how this knowledge can be affected and can be improved from the knowledge of the imaging system and the knowledge of material. In other words, traditionally we think about the electron or scanning probe microscopy image as an illustration. However, what we want to do is to learn the quantitative material-specific information, which is no longer depends on the microscope from this data. Our second step is whether we can use this material-specific information with the uncertainties determined by the incomplete knowledge of our microscope or intrinsic limitation of the physical measurements to infer physics and chemistry, either via the correlative models, so this is our machine learning, or the recovery of the generative physics, for example, force fields, exchange integrals, and so on and so forth. Our third step is, can we use thus determined material information, either correlative or causative, to reconstruct the material's behavior? The interesting part about the machine learning is that this analysis can be performed in real time, which means that we should be able to implement the real-time feedback for autonomous experimentation or atomic manipulation. So, which of those tasks have been done at this moment? So, the analysis of the image formation mechanisms and the extraction of the material-specific information is something that is actively pursued in the microscope community. The using of materials information to predict material behavior is the theory domain. However, the part when we take the images and use the image data to create the models of materials, either correlatives or reconstruct the physics of the material, is something that has been done to a relatively small extent. And in this lecture, we are going to talk about the recovery of the generative physics models, including the Ginzburg-Landau models and few examples of the dynamic or stochastic models from the STEM data. Now, where do we start? So our first step is to take our electron microscopy image and transform it into the physical descriptors that make physical sense. So one such descriptor can be polarization, or the dipole moment inside the unit cell. Another such descriptor is the octahedra tilts, which shows the tilt of oxygen octahedra inside the perovskite. Third type of such descriptors can be strains. So polarization and octahedra tilts are the example of the physical order parameters. Strains can be either physical in nature or can be Wegener strains or chemical strain related to the compositional fluctuation. So, the caveat here is that the electron microscopy image is a projection, which basically means that we have to treat the image plane and the data in the beam direction differently. Generally, we can resolve atomic columns very well, and therefore, we can measure the in-plane components of the order parameters. In the beam direction, we look at the projection, we still can determine certain parameters, for example, the preferential octahedra tilts in the Z direction, but we really need to treat the information in the in-plane and the beam direction differently. Now, let's look at several examples of the polarization imaging by electron microscopy. And in this case, it is simple transmission electron microscopy. So this is the example of the work done by one of my colleagues, Chris Nelson, while he was at the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory and in the University of Michigan. In this case, he explored the rhombohedral bismuth ferrite. So this is the material which has a perovskite structure with the polarization oriented in one of 111 directions. Once you look at this material in projection along 100 direction, the polarization vector can be oriented in two possible orientations. So by looking at the high-resolution TM focal series dataset, we can reconstruct in which direction is the polarization vector oriented, simply because we can see the central iron atom, we can see a much larger bismuth atoms, and we can see not very clearly, but we can see the positions of the oxygen atoms, and we can see how the oxygen atoms are positioned with respect to the central iron atom. So if we compare this representation to the schematic of the atomic distribution within the unit cell, we can reconstruct the polarization orientation inside the material. What makes it remarkably interesting is that once we reconstruct this polarization direction, we can visualize it in the form of the orientation maps, which tell us what is the orientation of the polarization vector. And lo and behold, once we do it, we can start with a simple electron microscopy image. So this is the bismuth ferrite deposited on the terbium scandate. We can visualize the domain orientations. So here it is done as the color maps. We can visualize them in the form of the vector maps. And lo and behold, we start to see very interesting elements of the domain structure. So in this particular case, you can see that the polarization start to form a very interesting closure domain patterns in the vicinity of the junction between the domain wall and the substrate. And the reason why these junctions form is to compensate the electric field and the boundary surface junction. So in this case, we get a quantitative picture of the polarization distribution inside the material, and we start to observe the new physical mechanism, because these closure domains will be a part of any dynamic process involving polarization, switching, domain wall motion, and so on and so forth. Now, this is another example of polarization imaging by this time by STEM rather than TM, when we visualize the atomic structure. So in this case, we don't have to do the wave reconstruction. We just visualize the atomic position. We can determine the positions of the bright atoms and the dark atoms. And then we can visualize the vector map that shows us the formation of these closure domains. Pretty neat. We started with the high-quality electron microscopy image, and we converted in the picture of the polarization distribution inside the materials that shows us ferroelectric domains and closure domains. A more recent example of such work is the visualization of the ferroelectric domain structures in the lead titanate, strontium titanate heterostructures. So in this case, you see this is a strontium titanate, this is lead titanate. And if we visualize polarization field inside this material, you can see that it formed the beautiful vortex structures due to the interplay between the depolarization and screening phenomena. So these vortex domains are a big thing. They were predicted more than 10 years by Van Naumov and Laurent Bilaish, and it took quite a while to visualize them. And now they can be created and they can be used in new materials and devices. Now, we can use the same approach to visualize the octahedra tilts. So this is the example of the TM exit wave reconstruction for the terbium scandate. This material has a characteristic octahedra tilt pattern in so-called A-A-C+ configuration. So this is one of the ways, one of the possible domain tilt patterns as classified by Glaser. And if you look at the electron microscopy image, you can see that the atomic features are clearly showing the tilts in the same sense as the tilts on the structure. And it turns out that we can visualize it by TM, and we can also visualize it by STM. So in STM, we can see the tilts in the bright field, which is here it is inverted to show the oxygen more clearly. And we can also see it in the dark field images, where we see primarily the cation columns. So the octahedra tilts can be also visualized both by TM and STM. Now, I hope I've shown you that we can map the physical order parameter fields, at least partially. So we can get the information on the order parameter fields in the image plane. So what? What can we learn from this data? And in order to understand what we learn from this data, let's just look at the classical physical perception of the order parameter. So for those of you who are familiar with the basic condensed matter physics, you've seen many times these figures of illustrating what is the phase transition inside the material. So it is very common to say that, okay, we have a material that can be in, say, cubic phase and in the tetragonal phase. We can depict the phase transition between this as the transition along this free energy surface with the one minimum corresponding to the phase one, another minimum corresponding to the phase two, and some reaction path that connects this phase one and phase two. So this picture is very simple, very intuitive, and as often happens, the simplicity of this picture actually hides the complexity of the physical phenomena behind it. So let's look at it in more detail. So the vertical axis in this case is energy, so this is simple, but the horizontal axis is a mysterious configuration coordinate. So the question is, what does this configuration coordinate mean? What it means is that the real material will contain macroscopic number of degrees of freedom, meaning that depending on how large is the piece of material, there can be somewhere around 10 to the power 20 unit cells in a 1 gram of material. However, the behavior of all these unit cells can be represented by a very small number of collective variables, or in other words, order parameters. So in other words, if the material undergoes phase transformation or any other change, all these unit cells change essentially in the lockstep. If we know the behavior of one unit cell, we can predict the behavior of the other unit cells to be exactly the same. So that's what the collective variable on the order parameter means. It means that system of multiple unit cell behaves as if there is only one parameter that controls the behavior of all the unit cells. Now, what are the caveats? The caveats is that not all materials behave like that. There are some materials such as ferroelectric reluxers, Kitaev materials, or morphotropic phase boundary materials, which have outstanding physical properties, but in which the presence of the order parameter is not a priori known. Second problem is that this behaviors, when all unit cells behave as if they're the same, is going to be different in the vicinity of the surfaces, topological defects or structural defects. So they are not necessarily covered by the same class of phenomena. And of course, experimentally, we don't have access to all of these degrees of freedom. So in macroscopic measurements, we get only the information about the average behavior of the material. So a spectacular case of this order parameter-based descriptions is, of course, ferroelectric. So in this case, we can develop this theory into the Ginzburg-Landau or Landau-Ginzburg-Devonshire type of theory, where the free energy of the material can be represented as some functional, which depends on the polarization, polarization gradients, elasticity, electrical depolarization fields, and so on and so forth. And it turns out that this Ginzburg-Landau theory can describe the mesoscopic dynamics of material remarkably well. So what you see in this animation is the example of the movie when the ferroelectric domains are switched under the action of the locally applied electric field, as simulated by Professor Longquin Chen group at Penn State. So, for bulk material, we will know the parameters of this Ginzburg-Landau equation very well. However, we typically don't know what happens with the boundary conditions at the surface and the interfaces. We typically don't know what is the role of the real defects. If I have a dislocation, how would it affect the order parameter behavior? And of course, the question becomes, can we describe the spatially inhomogeneous states, for example, reluxers or charged ordered materials or the morphotropic materials? And the problem with the mesoscale theory is that we really cannot find these parameters self-consistently. We need to get them from either atomistic theory or we need to get them from the experiment. So the question becomes, can we use electron microscopy data to provide this missing input into the phase field models? So, how are we going to do it? On the experimental side, it all starts with the observation, which gives us the partial information of the spatial degree of freedom. In other words, we see where the atoms are, and we can derive, with some limitation, the information on the other parameter fields such as polarization, strain, or octahedra tilts. We, of course, have no information on the energies of forces, so we see where the atoms are. We know that, of course, that corresponds to some minimum of the free energy, but we have no information on what the energies are. And we also have to take into account the instrumental correction. So if our instrument is not calibrated properly, that can be an issue. So on the theory side, we deal with the different levels of approximation, of course. So DFT theory and phase field theory operates at different levels of what is known about the material. Techniques such as bond valence methods and so on would be somewhere in between. But in theory, we know everything. We know the atomic positions, we know energies, we just don't know whether it corresponds to the experiment or not. So the task for us becomes, how do we compare the theory and experiment? So how do we make our observations qualitative? How we compare things with the simulation? If we push it further, can we elucidate the new mechanisms which were not in our original theoretical model? And can we extract the theoretical parameters out of the experimental data? So let me show you several examples. But before we go there, let me start with a very famous statement by Donald Rumsfeld, who famously said that there are no knowns, so there are things that we know. So that's ultimately how the theory works. We also know that there are known unknowns, so there are things that we don't know. But there are also the unknown unknowns, the ones that we don't know that we don't know, which is the one that tends to be difficult. So even though Donald Rumsfeld, strictly speaking, is not a scientist, this is very true for the scientific world as well. So when we do science, we try to learn the things that we know that we don't know, but we really have to be always careful about the potential for the unknown unknowns. What are the physical mechanisms that we didn't put in our model? What are the unusual observations or red flags that show up in our experimental data? So this is what makes science fun. Of course, it turns out that, as it often happens, the many smart things have been done said long before. And it turns out that, ironically, the almost similar statement was made by Nasser ad-Din Tusi, who was a Persian poet in about 12th century. So if you can look at this poem, that's basically exactly what it says. Anyway, what about seeing the new phenomena by electron microscopy? So this is the example of the electron microscopy image of the bismuth ferrite. And you can immediately see that something interesting goes on here. So in this case, in the bulk, you can see the beautiful bismuth ferrite structure. But close to the surface, you see that the material has changed. There is some kind of surface layer which has a different structure. It's no longer tetragonal. It seems like it's more cubic. And there is a transition layer between this cubic layer and the bulk tetragonal layer. In fact, we can analyze the polarization and via the out-of-plane and in-plane displacements. And you can see that there is a strong anomaly of polarization inside this layer on the interface between the material and epoxy. So in this case, we found something that we didn't know in advance. So there is some surface layer in the bismuth ferrite surface. What else can we learn about this material? So bismuth ferrite is a great material, obviously because of its multiferroic properties, but it's also a great material because it contains several sets of other parameters. One is the polarization, another is the octahedra tilt. And it turns out that for the same material, we can look at the octahedra tilt map, and we can see that the octahedra tilts on the complementary sublattices evolve on approaching the surface. So if we take our electron microscopy image, we take the atomic coordinates and convert them to octahedra tilts. So in this case, we get a map which looks like checkerboard. So in odd unit cells, the octahedras are rotated to the left and the even they're rotated to the right. And if we plot the average octahedra tilts, you can see that the tilt is about 11 degrees in the bulk of the material, but it becomes zero on approaching the surface. So the surface enhances the polarization, but suppresses the octahedra tilt inside the material. So maybe this is the indicator of the phase of bismuth ferrite with the enhanced polarization, but suppressed tilts. We have the polarization, which is positive in the BFR, and then it changes smoothly towards the interface and becomes negative in the LSMO. Here, we have polarization which is negative in the BFR, which sharply changes at the interface and is a little bit negative inside the LSMO. Basically, what it tells us is that the polarization inside the LSMO for some reason forms near the interface and it's really pinned there. It really doesn't want to change. If the polarization in the BFO has the same sign as the polarization in the LSMO, then the interface is very sharp. If the polarization in the BFO is positive, then the negative pin polarization in LSMO and positive polarization in BFO fight each other, and as a result, we start to have a very broad transition region. So the question becomes, can we add a little bit of numbers to this qualitative picture? The answer is yes, we can. So in this case, what we can do is we take this data, we convert it into the more numerical form. So we have the polarization profile for the BFOR LSMO interface when the BFOR is positively polarized and negatively polarized. Then we create a Ginzburg-Landau model. So we know the order parameter and the free energy for the bismuth ferrite. We assume that something happens at the interface. So we postulate that at the interface there is a fixed built-in charge. And then we try to fit our model to the experimental data. So it turns out that in this case it is possible. We can actually create a model where we have a built-in charge at the interface as the single parameter. And we can fit the data from both the thick and thin bismuth ferrite film to this particular model. We can show that the behavior in the LSMO is determined primarily by this built-in charge, and the magnitude of polarization behavior in the BFO depends on this polarization direction due to the non-symmetric effect of the charge. So in other words, what we have done is we took experimental data, meaning the polarization field in the behavior in the proximity to the interface. We postulated that we do know the properties of the bismuth ferrite and lanthanum strontium manganite. So these are well-known materials. We assumed that unknown value is the fixed charge in the interface. And we were able to fit our data to the model to derive the value of this fixed charge. We don't know where it comes from, but we can determine its magnitude. Now, what about more complex cases? So for the time being, I've shown you the example of the interfacial behavior, but what about the bulk behaviors? And it turns out that bismuth ferrite, upon doping, can show some very interesting examples of the complex atomic structures. So let's look at this phase diagram here. So if our bismuth ferrite is pure, it exists in the rhombohedral ferroelectric R3C phase. If we start to dope this material by rare earth, for example, samarium, at some doping level, it will transform into the paraelectric but orthorhombic material. So this is rhombohedral, this is orthorhombic. By definition, these two phases are crystallographically not compatible. That means that they are separated by the morphotropic phase boundary. And what's interesting is that in the vicinity of the morphotropic phase boundary, we often observe some unusual orderings. And for example, in the samarium doped bismuth ferrite, we know that there is a signatures of the four type ordering phase. But this is the data that we get from the scattering measurements. What can we see in the atomically resolved images? Well, let's look. So this is the example of the high resolution stem image from the samarium doped bismuth ferrite at the MPB phase. And in this case, if we analyze the distributions of atomic species, you can see that in some places we start to clearly see the modulation inside this material. So in this case, if we look at the XY plane, you can see that there is a modulated structure. Sometimes we see them both in X and Y, sometimes we see them oriented at 90 degrees to this orientation, sort of X minus Y. And what's interesting is that these modulations show on the bismuth or samarium sublattice, but they really don't show that much on the iron sublattice. So this is modulation that exists only on one of the cationic sublattices. So what goes on? Well, it turns out that in this case, we can explore the fundamental physical mechanism of this behavior in terms of the flexoelectric instability. So look about it this way. So the pure bismuth ferrite has the primary order parameter, which is polarization. So depending on polarization vector being positive or negative, we have a minimum around minus P or the plus P. At the same time, if we are close to the orthorhombic state, we also have the additional minima, metastable minima, corresponding to the positive and negative value of the orthorhombic order parameter. When we are far from any kind of domain wall or interface, then material exists in the plus P and the minus P state. So these are the primary free energy minima. However, if we are suppressing the polarization, either because we are at the domain wall where the polarization has to be zero, or next to the interface where the polarization can be zero due to the depolarization effects, that will actually give rise to the second minima corresponding to plus Q or minus Q state. So if we suppress the polarization, we create the conditions at which the secondary order parameter can manifest. So it turns out that once the secondary order parameter manifests, in the presence of the coupling between the polarization and strain, this flexoelectric interaction can destabilize the domain wall. In other words, domain wall, rather than being absolutely flat, will become wavy. And if our flexoelectric coupling is sufficiently strong, the domain wall can start to span the whole material. So material in some sense loses the stability and transforms into the modulated phase. So we can explore this behavior in more detail, and it turns out that there is a region on the phase diagram where this polarization instability, flexoelectric instability of the domain wall gives rise to this new modulated phase. And that's probably what we see in these experiments. Now, what about the chemical effects? Well, it turns out that in virtually all materials, there is a very strong coupling between the local composition and the lattice parameter. So this is so-called the Wegener strain effect. It turns out that this Wegener strain is relatively insensitive to the specific phase. For example, for materials such as lanthanum strontium cobaltate, the Wegener strains and the lattice parameter doesn't depend on whether this is a pseudo-cubic phase or the Brown-Millerite phase. In other words, the ordering doesn't change the magnitude of the strain effect. This in turn means that if we look at the material which have a non-stoichiometry, we can learn what is the local composition based on the local lattice parameter. So this is an example of the work when this approach was extended to the solid oxide fuel cell materials. And in this case, we can learn the local compositions based on the results of the stem images. So, what is the summary? The summary is that electron microscope becomes a really powerful multifunctional tool to explore the chemistry and physics of the oxide interfaces. Once we have the electron microscope image, we can use it to describe the C lattice parameter, sort of perpendicular to the interface, A lattice parameter along the interface. We can visualize tilts and polarization based on the analysis of the atomic positions. And it turns out that we can also add the chemical information from the electron energy loss spectroscopy. So this will tell us the local chemical compositions and the L to 3 ratios, local concentrations, and sort of depends on what material we deal with. This is the example of when we explore the combination of the multiple imaging techniques, including the polarization and lattice parameters, to actually analyze the electrostatics and electrochemistry of the interface between the two metal oxides. So in this case, we looked at the interface between strontium ruthenate, so this is a metallic oxide, and lanthanum strontium manganate, this is also metallic oxide. It turns out that at the interface, we have a polarization formed inside these materials. Based on this polarization, by multiplying it by Budder charges and differentiating, we can reconstruct the electric field across the interface. We can further reconstruct the potential. And it's kind of interesting, we start to see that there is a fairly complicated potential structure across this interface. And then we can reconstruct the electrostatics of the interface behavior. In this case, again, we assume that there is a polarization charge and the built-in charge of the polar interface. And based on the electron microscopy data, we can reconstruct them what they are, at least with some degree of precision. This is another example of this combined studies. When we look at the interface between the lanthanum strontium manganite and bismuth ferrite. And in this case, we have an interface between the lanthanum strontium manganite and bismuth ferrite with the polarization up, and the LSMO and the bismuth ferrite with the polarization down. So, interestingly enough, when the polarization is down, we can see that the transition between the bismuth ferrite and the LSMO is more or less smooth. But when the polarization is up, in this case, the transition is broad and there is a negative feature across the interface. If we look at the other data sets, for example, the lattice parameter, we can see that for the case of polarization up, our lattice parameter is actually slightly increased. Whereas for polarization down, the interface is not associated with any anomaly in the lattice parameter. So what turns out that in this case, if we have a down polarization of the screening in the interface is performed by the electrons, and if the polarization goes in the opposite direction, then the polarization charge is screened by the oxygen vacancies, but not by the electron holes. If the polarization is screened by the vacancies, then there is an expansion of lattice parameter, so the chemical strain, and we can also see a small signature in the ill signal that suggests that the SIG system is locally depleted. So in other words, if we explore the structure and functionality of the oxide-oxide interface, we can even determine the local electrochemistry of this system, which is very exciting. You can learn more about this work and the provided references, this set and this set. And now let's talk briefly about the more quantitative descriptions. So for the time being, I have shown you the examples of either qualitative or very simple quantitative models when we take the experimental data and we essentially tweak one parameter to fit the experiment to simplified theory. The question becomes, can we do this type of theory experiment comparison on a more systematic and more fundamental level? And the answer is yes, we can. So here you can see the example of the much simpler system. So this is a ordered Brown-Millerite lanthanum-strontium-cobaltate, where you can see that there are ordered oxygen vacancy planes, and you can see that these planes create the antiphase boundary. So it turns out that this system can also be described by the Ginzburg-Landau theory, and the bulk form of this energy functional is more or less known. However, what is not known is the gradient terms and the screening terms that determine the behavior of the order parameter across the interface. So the question becomes, can we learn these parameters from the electron microscopy dataset, and how universal would be this approach? And the answer is that generally what we can do is follow three steps. We define the free energy for the system. So this is our known parameters. We define our unknowns, for example, boundary conditions at the surfaces or interfaces, or the conditions on the topological defect. We analytically solve these equations for simplified geometries, for example, for the interface or for across the domain wall. Once we find this solution, in many cases it can be pretty simple, but it will contain the unknown parameter. For example, for the antiphase boundary, this is a length LC, and for the interface this is a length lambda. Interestingly, also LC is also part of the solution. So what happens is then is that if we have this analytical solutions, then we can directly fit this analytical solution for the experimental data and get this unknown values of either LC or lambda or more complex parameters. Now, why does it matter? It matters because the free energies for many materials are known or can be determined. However, application of the phase field theory is limited by the fact that we don't know the parameters that define the boundary conditions, and they cannot be determined from the mesoscopic theory self-consistently. Atomistic models tend to be a problem because very often the atomistic or DFT model for a system with a changing chemical composition can be very complicated. Being able to learn these missing parameters from the experimental data is really important because it makes our phase field theory useful. So it no longer has the unknown parameters. It has the parameters can be measured from the atomically resolved experiment. What's interesting is that this approach can be applied not only for the interface and gradient terms, it can also be applied for more complex couplings, for example, the flexoelectricity. So here you can see the example of the same ferroelectric vortices obtained by Chris Nelson while he was at Berkeley. So we see our strontium titanate, lead titanate heterostructure. Lead titanate layers have the polarization that's organized in this type of pattern. So this is the polarization in one direction, this is polarization in a different direction. If we represent the polarization field as the vector, you can see these vortices. So interestingly enough, for lead titanate, we know the Ginzburg-Landau energy pretty well, so it's relatively simple. And it turns out that we know the second order terms, fourth order terms, sixth order terms, we know the gradient terms, but there is one term that we don't know very well, which is so-called the flexoelectric term. So flexoelectricity is the parameter that describes the coupling between polarization and strain gradient, or polarization gradient and strain. And this flexoelectric coupling is extremely important on the nanometer scales, but it's very difficult to measure because on the mesoscale, it's indistinguishable from the chemical effects. So the question that we asked is whether we can learn the value of the flexoelectric term from the shape of the ferroelectric vortex. And it turns out that if we model the vortex shape for different values of the flexoelectric constant, it actually strongly depends on it. So if the flexoelectric constant is zero, then the vortex looks like squares. If it is higher, then it starts to develop these asperities. For high, it becomes more like a ninja throwing stars. And for very high flexoelectricity, the material stops being ferroelectric and start to develop this modulations, which is exactly the same modulations as we saw for the samarium doped BFO. So it turns out that we can have our theory, we can have our experimental data, we can use relatively simple computer vision algorithms in order to get the average shape of the vortex, and then we find the similarity maps which allow tell us how good is the match between the model and experiment as a function of the values of the flexoelectric tensor. And it, so in some sense, it's a quality surface. And it turns out that we have a very well-seen minimum, which basically allow us to pinpoint the value of this flexoelectric term out of the experimental data. And of course, this approach is not limited to flexoelectricity. If we have a sufficiently high-quality experimental data and we have a good theoretical models, we can find these unknown parameters from the data, as long as, of course, the number of unknown parameters is not too large. So you can read more about this work in the attached publications. And the next question you can ask is, does this approach apply only for the ferroelectricity, or can it be used for other types of data as well? And this is the example of the data when we look at the platinum nanoparticles, how they grow under the electron beam. And you can see that there is some interesting dynamics here. So the particle expand, they grow, and so on and so forth. So similar type of movies are available from other imaging techniques. So from optical microscopy or electron microscopy, we can see the mesoscopic particle dynamics. From ferroelectric measurements, we can observe the polarization dynamics. And in many cases, this phenomena have a large but limited number of the mesoscale dynamic models. For example, particle growth is the typical example of the reaction-diffusion process. Ferroelectric domain growth would be a process described by the Ginzburg-Landau theory. And the question we can ask is that if we have these movies, what can we learn out of them? For example, if we see the movies of the ferroelectric domain growing, can we learn the free energy expansion and the mobilities? If we see the particles growing, can we determine the reaction diffusion kinetics? What about things like the thermodynamics of the process or universality class of frozen disorder? So in other words, what type of physical information can we extract from these dynamic observations? So here you can see an example of this platinum particle growth. And the question becomes, how can we analyze it? And the first step, of course, is to take the data stream from the microscope, whether this is electron microscope or optical microscope, it really doesn't matter, and convert it into the data form. So we can work with it in Python or MATLAB or your language of choice. With this information in hand, we can perform the descriptive statistic analysis. For example, we can find all the particles in the image, and we can represent the process as this growth graph, where we illustrate the evolution of the particle population in the image plane and the function of time, as the graph that illustrates when the particles nucleate, how the particles merge, and how the particle size changes as a function of time. So this gives us the condensed representation of the system evolution and allows us to calculate the descriptive statistics. So for example, we can get the spatial localization of the nucleation sites, and we can see that this distribution is basically random. There is nothing special about it. We can also get the distribution of the nucleation times. So it looks like that in the beginning the nucleation happens in more places, and then it happens in the smaller number of places. And this is simply related to the fact that once the particle forms, it shades the other nucleation sites. We can look at the kinetics of the particle growth, and here we start to see something interesting. For example, the particles that form first grow faster, and the particles that form later grow slower. It makes perfect sense because the earlier formers have access to all the material in the solution, and the particles that formed nucleated later have to compete for the remainder of the solved component. But the question, of course, is can we learn something more quantitative? The descriptive statistics is great, but we know that the particle growth has to be controlled by a relatively small number of parameters, so primarily by the reaction and diffusion processes. And the question becomes, can we detect those? So let's look at the data in slightly more detail. So now you see how the two particles grow, how they evolve with the function of time. And what you notice is that the particle interact rather measurably. So you can clearly see that once they get closer to each other, then the growth slows down. And that makes perfect sense because the particle grow in the direction when they don't have any neighbors, where there is a free access to the material. In fact, we can visualize this behavior through the angular dependence of the local growth speed as a function of time. So once we are in the early stage of the particle growth, the growth rate doesn't depend on the orientation. And on the later stage, you can see that the growth rate is suppressed. And this happens exactly because these two particles are now close to each other. So you can see again how this process happens. Now, what can we do with this type of data? The answer is we need to find the simplest mathematical model that is simple so we can solve it, but at the same time it's sufficient to describe the problem at hand. And in this case we work with the reaction diffusion problem, so we assume that the concentration dynamic in the solution is given by the diffusion equation, and the rate at which the particle grows is determined by the adsorption coefficient of the interface. The limiting cases here are the fast diffusion, so in this case the growth will proceed with a constant speed and particles would not interact. Another limiting case is fast reaction. So in this case, we expect to have a zero concentration in the vicinity of the particle boundary, very strong interactions, and formation of the fractal-like particles. So this is also a well-known case. We know that experimentally we see that particles interact, but we don't see any fractality, which basically means that we're somewhere in between. So what we did to work in this case is to create a model where we have a MATLAB environment which detects the boundaries of the particles, sends this information to the COMSOL where we solve the reaction diffusion equation while varying the ratio of diffusion and reaction. Then we send this information back to the MATLAB and we compare the COMSOL prediction for different parameters to the experimental observation. Once we do it, we can see that for the certain value of the reaction diffusion ratio, the accumulated error is actually minimal. So look at these graphs. So if we have an optimal ratio between the reaction and diffusion, our experimental velocity, so the red dots, and the simulated concentration or local rate are virtually the same. If our diffusion is much faster, you can see that reaction rate would be uniform, and if the reaction is much faster, you can see how we develop the fractal instabilities. So there is an optimum, and this optimum corresponds to well-defined value of the reaction ratio of reaction to diffusion. And it turns out that this optimal ratio is actually stationary with time, which basically it means that we found the right solution, and this solution allows us to take the movie of the particle growth and extract the reaction and diffusion coefficient out of it. So you can read about this work more in this publication. Now, what about the atomically resolved data? So in this case, the work is, the science is only being done now. But let me very briefly illustrate some examples of how the same concepts can be used for atomically resolved data as well. So let's see how the modern physics is being done. So on the microscopic level, we often work with the microscopic model, such as Ising model, Heisenberg model, Kitaev model, and so on. So theorists work with these models. They calculate the macroscopic observables, for example, properties, average structure, fluctuations, and so on. On the other end, we have experimentalists who synthesize real materials, perform the macroscopic measurements, so heat capacities, magnetization, they take scattering data and so on. And then the comparison is done between the macroscopic measurements and the predictions of the macroscopic observables. So most of the time it works. Very often there is a discussion of what exactly a universality class specific material comports to. So is it Ising ferromagnet or is it Heisenberg ferromagnet? So sometimes the discussions get interesting. But the main idea is that the comparison is done between the macroscopic observables. And the question becomes, can we perform the same type of theory experiment matching through the microscopic observables? In other words, can we determine the local interactions from the atomically resolved electron or probe microscopy data? It turns out that this is possible. So this can be done using so-called stochastic model matching method. So here is the example. What you see in this slide is the experimental data when you have the scanning tunneling microscopy image of the layer superconductor. You can see the dark atoms and bright atoms, and you can clearly see that these atoms don't form random configuration. They really want to stick together. So dark atoms want to stick to the dark atoms and bright atoms want to stick with the bright atoms. It turns out that this type of behavior can be simulated very easily through relatively simple models, for example, interacting solid solution model, where the whole variety of these behaviors is described by just one parameter, so a specific enthalpy that describes to which extent atoms like to stick to each other. And the question becomes is, can we have a look at this experimental data set and determine the parameter of this lattice model out of the experimental data? And it turns out that it's possible. So we can use the metric called the statistical distance, which determines the difference between the experiment, between the images. And then we can minimize this matrix in order to get the parameter of the solid solution model. So in some of the next lectures, we are going to discuss in more detail how this can be done. So you can learn more about this work in the provided publications, and stand by for the next lectures. So in the next lecture, which would be the last one of this historical cycle, we are going to talk about the atom by atom fabrication by the electron beam. You're welcome to look at the lecture that's starting to appear in the Z corner, which talk about the deep learning libraries and more, and stay tuned.